can represent the NESD, which is
kind of a troubleshooting team that
yeah.
we have. And this is a real quick slideshow presentation. I'll get into some of the lease issues. I've been working on the lease issues now for a year. And just getting into the muck of it. But the good news, we NASA did a software capability, of engineering disciplines across NASA. The best way to run this up is the new chief engineer office does not feel we'll end up with a 10-year budgeted plan to do anything. Okay, it just happened with the kind of atmosphere and budgets and political environment we're currently in. So what abilities do we have to maintain at NASA of what they're telling us to do, such that we are prepared to use facilities if we are directed to do a particular project program. And closing down some facilities and continuing to maintain facilities that may not necessarily be used right now, but they are necessary for the future of landing on Mars or doing a rover or whatever else we're doing. Looking at the disciplines and saying, what do we need to do if we wanted to survive as an agency with the current budget so we could be agile or capable of doing one of the programs? For my particular group, we actually went through all the centers and came back with these high-budget areas. What we're looking for is, the first one there, level of requirements. I've been working on trying to get fault management requirements much better fleshed out in any of our reviews. Would be quite possibly we need a review simply for fault management, where that's all we review in one of these reviews. Offer release process is a big concern across all the centers. The infrastructure, meaning you can't build these virtual teams very easily. Who's managing it? Who's funding it? Who's doing the servers? We are required to do pure software at times, but we have no requirements. Nobody really understands what that amounts to and what requirements we should be meeting and how we would verify that we are meeting those kind of requirements. And then hiring issues. We're an old agency. And so what it amounts to is hiring young engineers. We are in competition with SpaceX. We're in competition with commercial programs right now. And what's interesting is particular centers that are near Google, particular centers that are near SpaceX, are having to compete for that person. And I had to do it before because we were the only one, in essence.
Yes. Security, were they looking at different components? White, ground, or was it?
White, across the board.
They differentiate them.
Yeah. Well, primarily you're dealing with encryption and things like that on your command uplink and downlink. But when you get to ground system, and even 32 ground systems doing fueling and things like this, they're concerned about, you know, having issues with that in terms of security. Where would they anchor, you know, or an attack of them? So we all, every discipline, I'm not expecting you to read this, comes to us, I have concerns about putting together a software library, and I presented that to the board. And this is way up to the budget committee. Full wind, avionics, flight mechanics, loads and dynamics, passive thermal propulsion. Everybody else wanted a software library also. Because we have a lot of clout, if you guys want a software library and a push for a software library, we're not the ones that want it. When I presented this, you were the CDFS was like 5 slides out of my 50 slides. Success story, exactly what Ralph Rowe and the chief engineer's office is looking for. Centers to join in on software so we can be more efficient and all that stuff. And we met through, but I'm in his meetings telling him how great you guys are doing with the CDFS. But I just point out the software idea and the software catalog that you guys are working. I can, and I'm keeping prepared. Well, my view to you guys is towards your requirements, no matter what everybody else wants to join in on, we'll use you as a pilot. And we'll say, well, they did it. I think we can do something very similar. And this goes to some of the stuff that PASS is doing with Bill Olvon and how the catalogs and things are coming along. Here, again, if you take a look at this list, I call that workforce issues. And this is the term of employment. They've been all of our requests and findings. How do we come across centers? If we wanted training from Goddard and they simply requested training from Goddard, but they can't get it because of a quota, but they can get training from Langley, but Langley doesn't know how to train what they wanted to train, but it was okay for the agency to, that made no sense whatsoever. How we have a WBS structure or some kind of funding structure that allows NASA or any of your other organizations to shoot people in these issues across the board. It was workforce shaping, which was work specialties. In fact, it's very interesting. If you go to the description that NASA uses to hire software engineers and hiring computer scientists, we still are okay. And that's not really the best match. If I was going to hire people, I'd hire a computer engineer or an EE engineer in like be more what an embedded system than a computer that can tell the big old or something. Okay. The good thing is what you are doing is right in the mainstream of what everybody else is looking for.
Okay. Good.
A thorn in our side and a thorn in more for time again working. I mean, it's been there. It's actually grown. When we leave software by carrying floppies in our back pocket, didn't have all this concern and mitigation and rules and everything that was going on, and it seemed just fine. And a lot of issues became up on these risks. It's more and more difficult to release software. And these are risks. And the interesting thing is very few of them are engineering risks. Okay? And from way above our pay scale. Okay? So because I talked to engineers, I said, how do I describe the release process in a way that we can understand it and say, oh, yeah, now that makes sense. Because it makes sense. Okay? So I think that is risks. So that you can determine how you distribute that software.
You end up actual litigation on who owns the software and how big a scope can you release the software
to your network cubicle. I call it really a secure issue. We develop trajectory software. And there are trajectory software that has become questionable as whether we want to release that to the general public. Falls right in my area, which is if we're going to use software and share software, it has to meet some level of either the person using it needs to know how far you tested it and what it should be used for in terms of the, like if you use modeling software, what kind of decisions can you use that software for? Well, two, and you should really use it as a, well, it gives you kind of a feasibility idea, or is it low level, whatever. And it turns out software is a little twisted because by some of the other disciplines can be except for this piece. It could be everything just great, but we have this parachute thing. Parallel level 9, 3 over here. So you have to understand those kind of things. So the misuse of software, meaning software said, well, we tested this, but we didn't test this, and you're probably using it this way. And in this manner, this kind of thing. But we don't normally get, many of these packages aren't even supported anymore. The next risk, I asked as I was sitting there this morning. current software can get away, can get out into the general public, could be directed to do that. Okay. Where that's the time, I'll get into this in a little more detail, but primarily they are trying to meet a charter, a quota, to get software into the general public. Okay. I think that was an end in engineering, but I'm finding that it gets in the way. Now, in the last two risks, so we say, really safe with litigation, security, and quality by simply not releasing software. Okay? And make it very difficult to release software because they're risks. Then these are us pushing back on them saying, yeah, but if you make those very difficult to release, we can't meet our technical or engineering.
Use, okay? But if you
concerned about a lot of that work yourself, okay? Perform. What are the results? Use of the software. What level of decisions do you think the software is used for? Document crawling tools. You know, this when you do a really good version description document, that sometimes these things just don't scope when they get the next version of the compiler. The way I would deal with it, if I use this software, what would I? How often is what I have? What would I would like to have to see if I wanted to use this software? That's you know, and that's where I spend most of my time. Security.
Are there things that you could start accumulating knowledge-wise for the CFS community? You know, if there's maybe a checklist or something people can do up front? You know, if we community, or maybe that's where we could get. You know,
some of these bullets are, in essence, the beginning of that checklist.
Right.
If I were to lay out some of the things you have to watch, actually, I have some slides that have come out of that. Let me see if I can weave and batten up the slides that are coming out. Trajectory, targeting, encryption, certain data issues, expert systems that we may incorporate, have certain security issues that we have to watch out for. This is sometimes what you can do to beat some of these things is you leave the encryption out. You build the whole thing, you stub out the encryption, you say, it's a great package, put your own encryption here. You know, just get away from it. Don't do it, guys. All right. Then there's a legal issue. Okay. This you can do for CFS. This is some of it. Legal, and they don't have any legal. Once it gets into legal, there's no pressure to them to meet some kind of schedule or budget. They're really in their own world saying, is this releasable or not? Okay. Actually, the lady. To start with, work statement of work or your delivery. You have to specify when this is done, who owns the software, and be very clear about that. Who owns it at the end of, you know, if we do this work across a lot of people's, you know, efforts in the virtual community, who owns it at the end has to be in there, or they can't decide the scope, they can't decide the release, because they don't have the ownership to make those kind of decisions.
Owner eventually be sort of the open source license? I mean,
I think the open source community is going to be much easier to deal with in this area because they're the other way around. Nobody owns it to the open source in that. There's certain agreements.
If that's the end point,
yeah.
Your example, that will satisfy.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. Well, I think one other aspect of that is I think then you'll need a contributor license, but it contributes back to the open source.
Bullet is seeing a lot. Most software isn't your software. You're incorporating libraries. You're incorporating other objects. You're incorporating pieces of board support packages, pieces of whatever. And they have software uses agreements and rewrites and everything else. When Lisa goes through these things, they search your source code looking for all the different copyrights and usage agreements embedded in the header files and whatever, because they want to make sure that not one of those says, hey, you can't where you're using it. So I mean, I have to tell you my experience, I don't read those darn things. I'll click the bucket and little click. I won't roll down the next 10 pages and say, you know, because I don't know what it means. But it's in the end. And the thing you do is, if you do include those packages, document those users. So when you can say, here's all the users you bring with your software, and we've already met those requirements. We're doing this part. Especially the board support package. You'd be surprised to use what comes with the board as a link to how you use their direction software that comes with it. And you're looking for it. Okay? Or support supports or abstraction layers or whatever. There's proprietary and confidential issues in specific interfaces. Check users agreements for supply of software. Your link into the software package does conflict with your ownership of the final package. Certain tools, certain compilers will only allow you to compile and release, you know, the open source.
that you can actually get in to the final arbitration and say, we own this software. Okay. What's in this inverse? We can see the development and the company with the contractors that were writing part of that software were sure that if we misused the software or the software caused some death or a lot of additional loss of the crew, that we would try to sue them because they actually were. That litigation that you were working for them supplying NASA with the software, and by the time they supply you with the software, they don't have anything to do with it. But they were done with that. We hadn't set up the ownership. They were with the software. They just didn't want to because they thought they'd be misused or something went wrong. That was kind of an interesting thing. You may have an application, certain functionality is partitioned out, and it's not necessarily an engineering decision. Or a design decision is for release. You park those pieces that you think are going to be a problem releasing, and you stub those out and you say, well, here's all the good stuff you can use, you're going to have to add this other app that works with it. And that's part of your planning. Release groups as packages. You know, team packages involves four apps. Well, release them all as four apps. The because they get to count them as their quota. Okay. The release four times to go through their process. Either we package things up and go through these processes as a package. Okay. No process that currently allows somebody else that owns software to say, I freely give this to NASA. I leave my ownership. Office to release software and the office to accept the software, and nobody wants to do it yet. Okay. Revision and versions are an interesting thing. In our NASA documentation, if a future version or changes, you have to go through the entire release process again. Major version number will never change. We'll have thousands of things out here in my memory. Version number where you can't change it, it just gives you a version number the next time through. Something we decide as when that next version comes up. But I haven't cracked that one yet. I wanted this to be quick, and from the point of view of you got to watch out because you don't have really a whole lot of control on what they're doing. You have to plan for the release up front and plan your ownership. Oversimple rights and, these tool suites. And have to partition it, maybe not in an engineering sense, but in a research sense. So they keep some stubs out because those could be problems. You can release, remove the encryption algorithm, say, plug in your encryption algorithm here, we've given you the rest of it. I think those are things we have to deal with. Any questions? I got a question back here.
Once you get the software out there, it's available, and then people use it and they update it, and how do you back it in? Is that a complicated process also, or is it simple? I just copy it and paste it and start using it.
It can go both ways. I think the open source is going to be much easier. I think if you're saying, I made these changes, and you can help me with it, is if you do the changes, you simply write the defects or requested changes to the original trunk package and put the defect tracking. So, delivering software, you're making suggested changes and letting trunk get changed. I think that's the best way to go. But there is entire packages that want to be relieved back from NASA, and we can't accept them right now. They just won't take that.
Professor at Howard University, but I have about 8 years working with the RTEMS project. in open source. And I just want to make a few mostly comments, not so much.
Yeah.
And one of the questions actually is, I can use the microphone if you want, that would be fine. Where is it?
We have a...
No, I think you know I think you did that.
When you talk about security risks, I think it's important to be more clear that these are national security risks. So when you're talking about ownership, the software is a complicated thing, as I'm sure you start mainly with is through copyright, right? So copyright is how ownership is set. So you can't transfer that directly in any sort of legal way. So our software, the owner of the open source software is or has the copyright. They like this to be used with the open source software. So employees write software, the US government, I think, holds the copyright. And if you refer to the open source community, the US government still holds the copyright. When you bring something back in, you still hold the copyright on it, but you have the right to use it.
But don't they, so the person that contributes back there, so it's to release any risk that their contribution is caused.
By license, it's a software license. So the open source license is a software license. And usually, as far as I'm aware, most of the open source licenses you have indemnification.
So
what about is that what I want to sort of recommend to, especially what you were talking about, what's your name again? I don't know.
Dave.
Okay. So when you talk about the model of NASA controlled assets and about pushing code out, suggest a flip model in that actually the open source community controls adoption procedure at NASA, that CFE, CFS, in a, becomes an open source project, and you feed the steering committee or board of trustees with NASA employees that you can and other interested parties, and control the product as CFS, and other important user entities into that. So I need to just let that be your thought. That our sense is used successfully for 20-something years, and it's a good sort of community-driven model.
That was excellent.
No, that's what we're looking for. I was trying to present more of a, what can you do sitting at your chair writing code, what you need to watch out for, what you're doing. Just like he was saying, the security aspects are way above our pay scale. Some of the aspects are actually dictated above NASA agencies.
I want to make one note on that, Elvis. One of the things we have is going back to some contractors who wrote on the software thing, going back 15 years ago, I wrote that, and finding who's the legal person we need to talk to get them to release that. You know, they make a contribution. And it wasn't sufficient to have some blanket license from a contractor as part of the contract, union contract. You have to find a person, whatever corporation they're with, to make all of their exists and try to work that. If you get that kind of stuff done early, you get that. So when you're developing something, that might be really good open source. You get all looked out at it.
One line on what I just presented is, it's put it in your plan.
Yeah.
Put it in your plan right up front. In a particular way, deal with that release
things, a couple of comments and questions. On software licensing, where you end up pulling together a report, the license has got STX.org now, which is annotation for all the standard OSI approved licenses and standard tag. You can actually put in all the software and they get their reports generators under Eclipse, which will actually generate for an open source tech all of the files. And so that's part of our team's plan is to put the annotation in the code for all the and try to run the license generator. So that particular router, when it's got the GPL and all the other licenses, that's actually generated by these tools. And then hopefully we can integrate from the build system so you won't get a view of all 190 BFCs. You'll get a view of just what you built.
You're getting on this, right?
Yeah. I'll tell you, people will try to sell you the same thing, but it's basically the Eclipse tools and FPGX. And how well it does with proprietary licenses is something I'll look at here for the OSI license. Well, security, you said national security. Are you all responsible for looking at like the NIC security controls? When you apply access controls and information transfer to those. So you've got the national security tech transfers and the NIST security controls. He is coming, working on open group space, which is top jet avionics standard. They have basically the issues you listed, Dave, where you do business and outreach. One of the things the business group has done, which was really helpful and probably rigid for CFE, CFS, they have recommended contract language. So space is now an open group standard. And it's recommended contract language to put in different types of acquisitions so that the Army legal plus there were 50 contractors, including the Boeing and the Lockheed's, and their legal has already reviewed it and pre-approved it. So, recommendations to put in the contract so you get ahead of the ball on how what rights you have and what recommended things to do. So, you see, here's kind of the language you should be putting in your contract to get the way it should work. So, everybody's getting the language every time.
This goes to general comment there. When all centers at NASA, each center has a different way of doing the release because we treat our centers almost in a competitive mode. And it's everything is exactly right, but they will have a different idea of what release agreement they put on their software from center to center to center. And it is not yet revealed into some agency wide.
One question I do have that was regarding NASA's efforts on using open source software. The question is that if we use it, how do we release it? Because what we tend to get is we tend to get a lot of different answers depending on who we ask.
Yeah.
So
exactly.
It would be good for us from a NASA standpoint to have sort of a procedure that about this, so or again, what you're talking about is like leader or a agent buyer, you need to be able to talk about the policy,
yeah,
and what those kinds of work is.
My work, I'm actually based out of the NESC, is based out of Langley. I'm working very tightly with Langley to get the NESC issues figured out. Once that's fleshed out, as we know how it works, we're hoping to spread their centers. They're all the software release authority working with the group and the people, some of the litigation folks who understand the problem, but funded to fix it. Okay. Not so I'm still trying to make channels to it. I'm open to these offers to see if I first pick Langley because I have a problem out there and just put another room against the
centers. I mean, at least if there was a model,
yeah,
then the centers can then start to copy. Now, like I mean, to me, the says that we're supposed to be re-releasing this back based on who you ask at the time. You don't want to take the risk at that point. The tendency not to re-release any of this code, and so any work that NASA does do goes into this quagmire that you were talking about.
Yeah.
Which at least open source and a lot clearer.
And the thing I would be very curious to see, remember this as being a problem 10 years ago. Software was under a program or project umbrella, and so they didn't even concern themselves with software that exists outside of that. But if you use software, DFE, DFS, selling software, all of this outside programs and projects. Because they want Europa, and they want to deal with how you land on Europa. Well, the program or project wants to fund that. They will fund models that support their particular regime and a modification and improvement of the model to support that regime. But no support is wrong, there's no funding for it. So we have internally so we can do the feasibility study. And it's a real quagmire. Yeah.
We've been waiting, I think, for the RTIMS BSP for, I think, 5 years now. Kind of like it pops up every now and again, and I just go, yeah, but then you won't be able to buy the board, so I won't care.
You